I'm here with Professor Lawrence Baker at Stanford Medical School, and what we're going to talk about now is just like the overview of the healthcare system.
What is the healthcare system?
Yeah, and who's in it?
And who's in it? And what are they doing?
I think I could give a go at it.
Go for it.
And then correct me.
Okay.
And expose my ignorance.
Okay.
So clearly, you know, you have your kind of your providers. That those would be your doctors and nurses and all the rest. And
hospitals,
hospitals,
pharmacies, all kinds of people.
Okay.
Providers.
So everyone who's providing healthcare.
Mm-hmm.
So that's right over there. So that's hospitals, doctors, pharmacies, all the rest.
Yep.
And then they are providing the healthcare to someone.
Yep.
So those would be the patients. Let me do that in another color.
Yep. Call them patients. Yeah. Sometimes you get details like, you know, people become patients after they need healthcare, but some people just have a question. They're not really patients. They're just asking.
Okay. And what would you call them then?
Call them population.
Population. Or so just the population of the world,
yeah.
Of the country or whatever,
people,
of the
yeah.
Oh, people. And then on the other, and then you, someone has to pay for this.
Someone has to pay for this.
And so for the most part, this is insurers.
Yep. Insurance companies. In the old days, like if you go back 100 years, we didn't really have insurers. We had patients and providers, and patients would, if they had a question, they had a concern, they'd go to the provider, they'd make some deal, pay them some money, do some service for them, and work it out.
Right.
And we got insurance companies really only in the last 100 years, maybe really starting in the U.S. in maybe 1930, 1940, they started to become popular. So that's kind of a newer innovation.
Right.
And those three things work together.
And the general term, and this is a word I've seen a lot, and sometimes it's a little confusing because it's very close to payer. It's like you hear that kind of these payors.
These payors.
And that would be including, that's anyone who's paying for the service.
Yes.
And that insurance companies would be included there.
Right. So we call them payers. Sometimes we call them health plans because they arrange for some of the care that people get. And, you know, payers could be private companies, private insurance companies, or they could be government payers, government insurance companies like Medicare.
And the insurance companies themselves, they're not doing this, you know, just out of the goodness of their heart. Someone is paying them.
Right.
And for the most part in the United States, it tends to be employers.
So, right. So we made another arrow on your diagram here. It would be from the population or maybe from the patients to the insurance companies that provides the money for the insurance companies to use to pay for the provider. So patients might buy an insurance policy.
Only if they're very well healed.
Some of
yes.
them buy the whole company.
There are a few.
Right? But patients might buy their own policy, go buy an insurance policy, pay them a premium directly.
Right.
The insurance company collects that money. Or for most people, they work for an employer. The employer makes the arrangement to buy that insurance and then implicitly charges the population, the patients, for that, maybe directly by having them contribute some of their salary,
right.
maybe implicitly by just reducing the amount
right.
of cash they give them every month and instead giving them this insurance
I
policy.
See.
So people do that. And the other piece that's floating around in here is that in some cases, the population pays taxes to the government
that then
functions essentially as an insurer, like the Medicare program, where there's insurance provided to people, it's paid for by taxes. So there's
right.
some different funds flows going around here, but always money going from patients to insurers through employers,
right.
through taxes, by direct payments. Those insurers collecting the money and then paying for a bunch of the care that's provided by the providers.
Right.
And that's the basic arrangement. There's one more tiny piece, which is mm-hmm. that sometimes patients pay the doctors or the hospitals directly.
Yes.
You know, you go, you have a $20 copayment.
Right.
And so there's a small payment that goes back and forth.
Right. Your copay is kind of there just so that it kind of makes the insurance company feel good that you're not just using it willy-nilly, that you have to pay your, you know, whatever, $10 or $50.
Absolutely. So insurers know that once they start paying the providers for the care and the patient says it's totally free, people might use stuff that, you know, might be worth a little tiny bit, but it costs a lot for everybody to pay for. So if you put a copayment on there, it makes people think twice about using things that they don't really need very much.
Right. No, it makes complete sense. And then within this ecosystem, you know, we hear a lot about HMOs. That my perception is that's a combination of the insurance company and the provider. It's kind of in one package.
Right. So over time, the U.S. has had different kinds of insurers mm-hmm. out there. In the private market especially, there's been a lot of innovation in the last 30, 40 years in types of insurers that are out there. So we have different insurers that have behaved in different ways as we've gone through those evolutionary cycles. Mm-hmm. So one version of that is what we call an HMO, a health mm-hmm. maintenance organization. And that's really just jargon. You have to dig into it to figure out
right.
what it means. But in a lot of cases, what that is a company that's acting as insurance. So you pay a premium to them if you're a patient
right.
or a person, and you buy some coverage. And then they'll cover your care, but they'll do that by trying to integrate themselves with the providers.
Right.
So the organizations either are integrated because the HMO hires doctors directly or maybe right. owns the hospitals, like Kaiser Permanente, for example.
Right.
Or in some cases, it's a contractual relationship
oh, right,
that's not
right.
exactly the
so
same.
So none of them
hiring.
Are as tightly linked to like a Kaiser, where it's like you go to this building that says Kaiser on it, and that's where your doctor is. It could be doctors just have their practices, but they're tightly linked with Blue Shield or one of those.
Yeah, Blue Shield or Aetna or Cigna, right. some of these different companies. And you can start to dig into the details, and every one will be a little bit different
right.
from the other.
And
they're contractual relationships.
Right. And the difference, and I think this is something everyone faces when they, you know, sign up with insurance with their employer. I had to do it recently, is, you know, they always say you have to pick HMO versus PPO. And they're within the same policy. And so my perception is HMO is you have a set list of doctors that they've probably pre-negotiated pricing with.
Yeah. So the difference between HMOs and PPOs gets a little bit into the into
okay,
the
details, I don't want to get too into the weeds.
We can sort of think about it in the way that
right.
you're talking about it. So an HMO will have a list of doctors that you're supposed to see,
right.
and you'll have to go see doctors on that list. In a stereotypical one, if you don't see the doctors on that list, the insurance company is not going to pay for your
right.
care. You're going to pay
right.
yourself. And in a stereotypical HMO, there's going to be a fairly tight management between the insurance
right.
company and the doctors about what's going
right.
to be done, what's allowable, and so on.
And in the most tightly linked case, they'll be like the same.
They'll
be
the same
will be employed
company.
By the company. Right,
yeah.
That's like, right, Kaiser.
As you kind of think about it as a spectrum, if you move a little bit away from that to a PPO, what's
right.
happening in a PPO is you're still going to get a list.
Right.
So you're going to be encouraged to see those doctors, but maybe there'll be a little more flexibility. Like
right.
if you decided not to see someone on the list, the plan would still pay some amount, maybe not as much as they would if you saw someone on a list, but something, whereas in an HMO, maybe nothing. And the plan will probably work a little less hard at managing what those doctors are doing to try and limit access to, say, high-cost
right.
services. HMO will tend to work harder. PPO tends to work
right.
a little less hard. So it's a little bit of a spectrum. You're kind of moving from more managed and more concentrated to a little less managed, but still more so than the system we had, say, in the 50s or 60s, where anybody went to any doctor and any doctor did whatever they wanted, and the insurance company just paid the bill and there was no
right.
integration. So it's a little bit of a...
So that's the main motivation why insurance companies are trying to get kind of more integrated with the providers, is because, just like you said, in the 50s and 60s, you have the provider providing a service, and obviously the patient would like the service, and then you have a third party paying for it. And so there's no check on... You know, the person deciding on the service and the person getting it says, yeah, let's get more service, and someone else is right. And
so right,
that's
just, so we created a big issue. Insurance companies are kind of an interesting thing in a health policy world, because we have to have them.
Right.
We have to have them to manage the risk associated with getting sick. You can get sick
right.
today and get a huge bill, and so we can't leave people on their own for that. We
got right.
to have insurance companies. But as soon as you create insurance companies and I can have implicitly all my neighbors pay for the health care that I want,
right.
then I might start using things that turn out to be inefficient. And so
right.
you got to have them, insurance companies, but you got to manage what happens when you have them also. And so that's the integration between providers or co-payments and utilization review, and all these things are basically attempts by insurance companies to try and manage what economists would call the moral hazard, the using additional
yes.
services that you don't necessarily need because everybody else is going to pay for it for you.
It makes complete sense. Oh, well, thanks. That makes a ton of sense.